May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all for being part of this celebration of the personality whose name has become our mark of identity. We are actually not just Shia, we are Shi'atu Ali, followers of Ali bin Abi Talib, the brother of Ali, the brother of the Prophet, the husband of Fatima, and the father of Hassan and Hussein, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. May Allah bless our youths for the enthusiasm they are showing in expressing their words about the villa and the love for Ahlul Bayt. However, keeping the restraint in time, I know Mukhi is very much under pressure at the moment, but we have to go through the rituals anyway. Let me start with this ayat which I recited from Sura Tawbah, ayat number 32. Sura Tawbah is one of the last surahs to be revealed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُرِيدُونَ أَن يُطْفَعَ نُورَ اللَّهَ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ, that there are people who wish to put out the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would like to blow off the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with their mouths, بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَعْبَ اللَّهَ إِلَّا. When we talk about the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is not nur. Allah is khaliqun nur. Nur is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are various manifestations of the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and one of the best example of the nur of Allah is the personality of Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. In that light, this ayat is saying that one example of this would be that there are people who try to, you know, put off the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَعْبَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا. But Allah fully intends to do nothing but أَن يُطِمَّ نُورُهُ, to protect His nur. And if Allah is so much intent in doing it, people can do whatever they want. You know, people during the early days from the Umayyads to the present time in form of the Wahhabis and the Salafis, they have tried their best to diminish the name and the image of Ali bin Abi Talib. But they were losers in the past, and they will be losers now and in the future. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَعْبَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا. Allah intends nothing but أَن يُطِمَّ نُورُهُ, but to protect and complete His nur. Salawat on Ekbar. For us, Ali is not only a good Sahabi, he's not only a learned scholar, he's not only a very pious person, he's actually the pure embodiment of Islam. The Prophet of Islam brought the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is known as Islam. That message in form of theory manifested in form of the Qur'an. But if you look at that message in form of a practical example, it manifested in form of Ali bin Abi Talib. So basically, when he brought Islam, he brought Qur'an on one hand and Ali on the other hand. Both are the miracles and the mu'jizat of Rasulullah to the Ummah. You have to look at the Qur'an, learn what you have to do, look at the example of Ali, and this is where you have to follow. And he expressed this very clearly in Ghadir when he says, "Inni tarikum fikum as-saqalain." I am leaving two saqalain. Remember the first question? Let's see how many of you got it right. 42 got right. 11 got it wrong, and another 11 also got it wrong. So we had to work hard on this. It's one third were wrong, you know, two thirds were okay, which is alhamdulillah. So Saqalain is not the Students Association. That is actually the name they take from this hadith of Rasulullah in Ghadir, where he says, "In nitarikum fikum as-saqalain." I am leaving two precious things among you a source of guidance. One is Kitabullah, the Book of Allah, the Qur'an, and the other is Itrat Ahlul Bayt. And at the head of, as the head of the Ahlul Bayt, we have the personality of Ali bin Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat from the Quran. The life of Ali can be summarized in a symbolic way. It's a life which started in a masjid and ended in a masjid. If you look at Ali in a symbolic way, he was born in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Kaaba, which is Masjid al-Haram. And he was fatally injured in the mihrab of Masjid al-Kufa. And in between that Viladat and Shahadat, he lived in a house in Medina where the door of his house opened into Masjid al-Nabi. What can you say about someone? Was born in a masjid. We have four important masajid in the world. One is the birthplace of Ali. Another is the Shahadat place of Ali. The third one is the house of Ali. And this is where we see that he became, you know, an embodiment of true Islam and the pure Islam. And this is where we see that one of the fadilat of Ali is that Ali never ever, neither his childhood nor his youth nor later on, ever placed his forehead down in worshipping any idol. And this is something where we see a unique status of Ali among the Muslims who actually were born before Islam, among the Sahaba. Almost all of them were either worshippers and mushrik before they became Muslims. But when it comes to Ali, he has this, you know, privilege and honor. No one can be, you know, same like him. And this is where we see this attempt to diminish the status of Ali starts. Let me start with one example here. You know, when we look at history and we look for the person who was the first Muslim, the historians, they say, well, you know, among female gender, Khadija, we don't have a problem with her, that's fine. When they say, then they say, okay, on the male, and they say, well, on the male side, there were two, baligh and non-baligh. Baba, when did you start all this categorizing? Because they wanted to put Ali down, they said, well, among the minor, the first Muslim is Ali, but among the adults is someone else. They tried to put Ali down by saying he was a minor when he became a Muslim. Yes, he was not baligh. But this is where, you know, يَعْبَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَن يُطِمَّ نُورُ. You can do whatever you want. Allah works in mysterious ways. When they say that Ali was a minor when he became Muslim, they were actually not diminishing his status. They were elevating him. Because according to Islamic laws, the status of a child is not his own. The status of a non-baligh child follows the status of the father. This fellow didn't realize that by saying that he's a minor and we still accept his statement, you are actually not knowingly agreeing that Abu Talib was also a Muslim. Shahadat by a non-baligh is not recognized in our Sharia. When you say Ali was a minor, you're actually saying that the rules apply to Ali differently from others. For other minor children, their statement has no value. But Ali, whether he's a minor or an adult, his statement is equally valid at all stage. And this is where we see that the Prophet himself, you know, when Ali was only 12 years old, introduced him as Akhi, Hadha Akhi wa Wasi wa Khalifati. that he's my brother, he's my wasi, he's the one who is going to execute my will, he is my successor. And he was only 12 years old at that time. Where did Rasulullah utter those words? This is where we have to work on hard, huh? Question number two. Where did the Prophet say to Ali that he is my brother and wasi and successor? We have 180 who said Ghadir, which is wrong. We have 17 who said in Fath Makkah, which is wrong. We have 42 who gave the right answer. It was in Da'wat Zul Hashira. Salawat Pranak Barar. We had a Da'wat Zul Hashira also, you know, where food is given first and the message is given later on. Salawat Pranak Barar. But from our point of view, this question, when did Ali become a Muslim? Whether he was baligh or non-baligh is irrelevant. I've given this example before, but just a reminder, you know, we get tea. Today, maybe it's coffee, I don't know. When you get tea, tea by nature is not sweet. So when you get the tea which is sweet, it is right for you to ask this question, how did the tea become sweet? And your answer would be, well, we put sugar in it. So you had to put a foreign element in the tea to make the tea sweet. Because sweetness is not the essential quality of tea. But then you ask the same question about the sugar. When did the sugar become sweet? Then they will say, well, this is not a valid question. Nobody in the world will ever buy an entity known as sugar if it is not sweet. Because sweetness and sugar go hand in hand by definition. Sugar is sweet from the time it came to exist. Whereas tea was not sweet, you had to put sugar into it. When it comes to all the Sahaba, you can ask, when did you become Muslim? Because they are like tea with sweetness. When it comes to Ali, you don't ask this question. Because Ali and Iman are like sugar and sweetness. Salawat Pandek Bara. Iman is an internal issue. Islam is the matter of tongue. Somebody can say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. You can say, well, you are a Muslim. But what certificate do we have for the Iman? Because Iman resides in the heart. And that is where Rasulullah says, if you really want to see whether this person's heart has Iman or not, Ya Ali, لا يحبك إلا مؤمن ولا يبغضك إلا منافق. It is the hub of Ali which becomes the criteria or the measure and standard to know the iman of an individual. So don't ask this question, when did Ali become Muslim? Because Ali is the mi'yar, he is the measure and the standard for the iman of the Muslim. Salawat Pranayak Barar. And so this status of Ali, that he never bowed down to worship an idol, is such a great honor that we see that Sunni Muslims in general, they actually respect Ali because of that. They have a special way of describing Ali, and they do not describe any Sahaba or Khalifa with those words. When they mention the name of Ali, they say, Karram Allahu wajhuhu. They don't use the word Radiyallahu anhu. And what does the word karramallahu wajhu? Karramallahu wajhu means Allah has honored his face. Because this face of Ali is the face which never went down in worship of an idol. And this is where we had this question that, you know, the third question, karramallahu wajhu. 51 of you answered this is applied for Khulafa Rashideen, which is wrong. 43 of you said it can be used for all the Sahaba, which is wrong. Even Sunnis don't do that. And 145 of you say it's only used for Ali, and which is the right answer. Salawat upon Akbar. And for centuries, Sunnis have been honoring Ali. Remember, this is not used by the Shias. Sunnis for centuries, when they mention the name of Ali, they say, Karramallahu wajhuhu. Karramallahu wajhuhu is affirmation of the honor that Allah has given to Ali. It is not the dua when you say, Radiallahu anhu. And this tradition has been there until Wahhabism emerged on the scene of the Muslim world. And the Salafis, using their petrodollars, they have been propagating this idea that this is a bid'ah. Don't do this. I was just looking at that website, especially the ones that muftis use for answering questions. And there are questions about it. That this term, karramallahu wajhu, is it only exclusively for Ali? They said, no, this is not for only Ali, for everyone. Better not use it. Just use radiallahu anhu. Unfortunately, this bid'ah is spreading among the Sunnis now. Unlike the past where whenever they would say Ali, they would say karramallahu wajhu. Now they are starting to say Ali radiallahu anhu. Why? Because these websites say that you have to treat the Sahaba equally. They even have problem with the Shias using the term alayhi salam for Ali. They bring this whole issue, well, alayhi salam is only used for Anbiya and Mursaleen and not for others. And this is where I would like to say that, you know, the Wahhabis call themselves Salafis. Salafis means those who follow the early generations of Islam. Wahhabis are not really Salafis. If they really go and study the history, you will see many Sunni historians, people like Tabari, Ibn Sa'ad, Maqdisi, Ibn Qutayba, Ibn Athir in Al-Kamil, Bayhaqi in Dala'il al-Nubuwa, Ibn Khaldun, Balawuri, and Al-Dhahabi, and many others. When you see when they are writing the name of Ali, and we are talking about early days, till about 8th century of the Islamic era, when they mention the name of Ali, they use these words, karramallahu wajhu. When you look at the muhaddiseen, those who compile the hadith among Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, there you will see they use the word alayhi salam for Ali. Historians use karramallahu wajhu, and the muhaddiseen use the term alayhi salam for Ali. And in that you will see Musnad of Ibn Mubarak, Musnad of Ahmad bin Hanbal, Sahih Bukhari, Sunan Abu Dawood, Sunan Nisa'i, Sunan Dar Qutni, and many others. They use this you know, expression, alayhi salam, after the name of Ali bin Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wa salam. Salawat bin Akbar. So the Wahhabis don't follow the Muslims of the first generation, no. Actually, a very interesting example is of Bukhari. In Sahih Bukhari, it seems he knew that it is important to give a distinctive status to Ahlul Bayt compared to all others, Azwaj as well as Ashab. One example that I would like to share with you, you know, when he mentions the name of Ali, not all the time, but there are instances. The name of Ali, the name of Hassan, the name of Hussein, even the name of Ali Zainul Abideen, Imam Bukhari in Sahih Bukhari says, alayhi salam. More interestingly, is that when he writes the name of Fatima al-Zahra, 26 times Bukhari has mentioned her. Every instance, every time he writes the name of Fatima al-Zahra, he writes, alayha salam. The last question. When you use this term after Fatima, you don't say alayhi salam, that is for male, masculine form. Alayhum salam would be plural. Alayha salam would be the right one. And we, alhamdulillah, got about 124 right answers, but there were about 124 on the wrong side also. So remember, especially those who make the announcements, when you use the name of Fatima, don't say alayhi salam. It is alayha salam, because that is the feminine term used for Fatima al-Zahra. Salawat. So Imam Bukhari in Sahih Bukhari, 26 times, wherever he mentions the name of Fatima, he uses the words alayha salam. Interestingly, even when in the same line he mentions the name of Aisha and the name of Fatima, after Fatima he would say alayha salam, and after Aisha he will say radiyallahu anha. So even Imam Bukhari knew that the status of Fatima al-Zahra is higher. She deserves to be mentioned by the words alayha salam and not radiyallahu anha. Salawat. And who said that all the Sahabas are to be treated equally? Not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's not the standard that He has given to us. Look at the Quran. We are not even talking about kufr and Islam. We are talking about among Muslims themselves, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talks about ilm, in Surah Mujadala, Surah 58, Ayat 11, يَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمُ دَرَجَاتِ. Those among you who have iman, and those who have been given knowledge, يَرْفَعَ اللَّهُ, Allah raises them, elevates them, بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ, and Allah knows, وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually raises the status of those who have iman and ilm. Surah Zumar, Surah 39, Ayat 9, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِيَ الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah says, do you think those who have knowledge and those who don't have the knowledge, هَلْ يَسْتَوُونَ, they are equal? Allah doesn't give the answer there. He appeals to our intelligence, where He says, إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. The people who have intelligence, they know the answer. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ يَسْتَوِي. Are those who have knowledge and those who don't have knowledge, are they savvy? Do they have musawat? Are they equal? This is what the Wahhabis are telling us. No. Those who have knowledge are superior to others. And when it comes to knowledge, is there anyone among the Sahaba can ever even come close to Ali? Isn't the Prophet who said, Ana Madinatul Ilm wa Aliyun Babuha? If you want the ilm from Rasul, you have to come through the door of Ali bin Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat. Surah Nisa, Allah shatters this myth of treating all the Sahaba equally. No. لا يستوي القاعدون من المؤمنين غير أولي الضرر والمجاهدين في سبيل الله بأموالهم وأنفسهم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that those mu'mineen who sit down without an excuse and keep away from jihad, they are not equal to those mu'mineen who go for jihad. So the mujahideen are, you know, of a higher level and status than those who are qa'ideen, who are just sitting. فضل الله المجاهدين بأموالهم وأنفسهم على القائدين. Allah continues in that ayat. Allah has excelled, elevated the status of those who are mujahideen over those who are qa'ideen. Qa'ideen means those who sit, don't go for jihad. And then he ends again, وَفَضَّلَ اللَّهُ الْمُجَاهِدِينَ عَلَى الْقَائِدِينَ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has excelled the mujahideen over the qa'ideen in a very great manner. And so even on the level of jihad, is there anyone in history of the Sahaba who can even come close to Ali ibn Abi Talib? You know, the zira of Ali, the armor of Ali, was only from the front side. His back was exposed because he never turned his back to the enemy and ran away. And so nobody can even come close to Ali when it comes to the issue of jihad. So you have ilm there, you have jihad there. And the final ayat on this issue, Surah Sajda, Surah number 32, ayat 18. أَفَمَنْ كَانَ مُؤْمِنًا كَمَنْ كَانَ فَاسِقًا لَا يَسْتَوُونَ. A person who is a mu'min compared to a sahabi who is a fasiq, Walid ibn Mughira. And the mu'min here is Ali ibn Abi Talib. Go and read at the tafasir of Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that sahabi who is a mu'min and a sahabi who is fasiq, la yastawun, they are not on the same level. Don't tell me that we have to treat, you know, Ali with all the sahaba equally. No. Ali is actually the mizan and the measure of the iman of the rest of the sahaba. Salawat. And so to diminish the status of Ali is actually challenging the standards that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for excellence in the ayat of Quran. When it comes to ilm, when it comes to jihad, when it comes to iman, Ali is there at the top. And actually to bring Ali down to the level of others is not only the issue of trying to treat everyone equally, actually this is zulm and injustice to Ali ibn Abi Talib. But we have to be, you know, clear about this issue. The name of Ali, the image of Ali is up there, not because of me and you, not because of our tabligh, not because of our enthusiasm, because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because يَعْبَ اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَن يَطِمَّ نُورَهُ. People can do whatever they want. That even when United Nations, in year 2002 probably, if I don't remember the year here, when they decided to write a report on the development of the Middle East and Arab countries, they actually suggested to them certain, you know, measures of reform. And there they told the Arabs and the Muslims, you don't need to look at the example of the West. Go to your own history. Look at the example of Ali ibn Abi Talib and follow his example for your own development and success now. Salawat. Ali ki azamat, Ali ka naam, Ali ki fazail ka muhafiz, khudawand alam. Aap soch le, 70 saal, almost 60 to 70 years, Banu Umayya ne koshish ki Ali ke naam ko dabane ke liye. Logon ke naam change hote the, dar ki wajah se. لیکن پھر بھی آخر میں آپ دیکھیں, آپ کو معلوم ہے کہ امام احمد بن حنبل کے زمانے تک خلفہ راشدون سے مراد چار لوگ نہیں تھے, صرف تین تھے. یہ تو امام احمد بن حنبل کی کوشش تھی کہ نہیں, علی کو بھی اس میں انکلوڈ کیا جائے. 99.9 of Sunnis don't even know اپنی ہسٹری. وہ سمجھتے ہیں خلفاء راشدین ہمیشہ چار تھے. نہیں, علی کے نام کو چھپایا گیا علی کے نام کو دبایا گیا لیکن خداوند عالم انہی لوگوں کے ہاتھ سے علی کے نام کو دوبارہ بلند کرتا ہے شیعوں نے علی کو اس میں انکلوڈ نہیں کیا ہے معاویہ کا نام کبھی نہیں آیا لیکن علی کا نام خلفاء راشد میں انکلوڈ کیا گیا ہے امام نسائی کی ایک روایت ہے سٹیٹمنٹ ہے جہاں کہتے ہیں لم یرد فی حق احد من الصحابہ بالاسانید الحسان کہ کسی بھی صحابی کے بارے میں اچھی یعنی کریکٹ اور اوتھینٹک احادیث اتنی نہیں آئی ہے ما جاء فی علی جتنی تعداد میں علی ابن ابی طالب کے فضائل میں آئی اتنا دبانے کے باوجود علی کے فضائل شیخین کے مجموعی فضائل سے بھی زیادہ ہیں سنی کتابوں میں تو یہ کام ہمارا اور آپ کا نہیں ہے یہ خدا کا کام ہے یہ خدا جب اپنے نور کے حفاظت کی ذمہ داری لیتا ہے تو وہ بچاتا ہے اور وہ ہمیشہ اس نور کو ہمیشہ بلند اور بالا رکھے گا آپ سوچ لیں کہ ایک اور ہسٹورین ہے جو کہتا ہے کہ ہمیں تعجب ہے اس شخص پہ کہ جہاں ان کے چاہنے والے خوف کی وجہ سے علی کے فضائل کو بیان نہیں کرتے تھے اور ان کے دشمن بغض کی وجہ سے علی کے فضائل بیان نہیں کرتے تھے لیکن پھر بھی علی کے فضائل اتنے ہیں کہ ایک جگہ جمع کرنا مشکل ہے یعنی اگر آزادی ہوتی تو کیا ہوتا محب جو ہے ڈر کی وجہ سے اور مبغض جو ہے بغض کی وجہ سے فضائل کو چھپائے پھر بھی سب سے زیادہ فضائل صحابہ کے اگر آئے ہیں تو علی ابن ابی طالب کی ذات میں آئے ہیں صلوات پڑھنے پر امام احمد بن حنبل بہت ہی عجیب کریکٹر ہے یہ ایک گفتگو ہے ان کی بایوگرافی ہے جو بیٹے نے لکھی ہے فضائل الامام احمد بن حنبل بیٹا کا نام تھا عبداللہ عبداللہ بن احمد بن حنبل ایک انٹرسٹنگ کنورسیشن وہ بیان کرتا ہے کہ ایک بار ہم نے اپنے بابا سے حدیث سفینہ سنا یہ حدیث سفینہ سنی ورژن جو ہے صحابہ کے بارے میں تو بعد میں بیٹا جو ہے باپ سے پوچھتا ہے یا ابتا ما تقول فی التفضیل کیا آپ کی نظر میں صحابہ میں افضل اور مفضول کون ہے ہاؤ ڈو یو گریڈ دیم ہو از ایٹ دی ٹاپ تو امام احمد بن حنبل جواب دیتا ہے فی الخلافہ ابو بکر و عمر و عثمان کہ جہاں تک خلافت کی بات ہے تین نام لے لیے اس نے اب بیٹا جو ہے انتظار میں تھا کہ بھائی عثمان کے بعد شاید علی کا نام لے چونکہ گریڈنگ اس طرح سے کی تھی کہ فرسٹ ابو بکر سیکنڈ عمر تھرڈ عثمان جب علی کا نام باپ نے نہیں لیا تو بیٹا کہتا ہے فقلتو میں نے بابا سے پوچھا فعلی بن ابی طالب علی کہاں گئے اس وقت امام احمد بن حنبل کہتے ہیں یا بنی علی بن ابی طالب من اہل بیت لا یقاس بہم احد تم نے صحابہ کی بات کی تھی بیٹا علی جو ہے صحابہ میں نہیں ہے اہل بیت رسول میں سے ہیں ان کا معیار کچھ اور ہے ڈونٹ کمپیئر دیم ٹو دی صحابہ لا يقاس بهم احد do not ever compare anyone with the اہل البیت تو یہ غلوب نہیں ہے ایگزیجریشن نہیں ہے ایکسٹریمزم نہیں ہے یہ عین حق اور حقیقت ہے یہ ہمارا مذہب ہے اور خود ان کی کتابوں سے اور انہی کے کلمات سے آپ دیکھتے ہیں کہ اتنا کوشش کی گئی کہ علی کے مرتبے کو دبایا جائے گھٹایا جائے نام کو ختم کر دیا جائے لیکن خداوند عالم نے ہمیشہ علی کے نام کو بلند و بالا رکھا ہے اور انہیں فقرات کے ساتھ خداوند عالم کی بارگاہ میں دعا ہے خداوند اس قلیل بات قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خداوند ہمیں وہ معرفت دے کہ ہم صحیح معنوں میں علی بن ابی طالب کے عظمت اور ان کے فضائل کو سمجھ سکیں اور اس کو برداشت کر سکیں اس لیے کہ یہی معیار ایمان ہے یہی ایمان یہ معیار نجات ہے خداوندہ جہاں بھی شیعان علی ہیں ان کو اپنے زمان میں رکھ، تکفیری افواج کو نیست و نابود فرما، امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم.